question is why? Why do we even want to or worry about training somebody that's just in the office? To reiterate though, everyone impacts safety. So question that came in was, you know, there's a lot of crazy stuff going on in the world right now. What if they get a suspicious box? It could have, you know, what if it is suspicious? Do your CSRs know how to handle things that come in? They may be the first person that touches it. And I know that's not necessarily propane related, but it is safety related. And again, they may be the very first person to touch any of those kind of safety sensitive things. So everyone does have an impact. How they answer the phone may truly be life or death. I have had many, many, many classes with CSRs, and I'm not speaking about with my current company, but I mean in large groups where there's many different organizations represented, so there's a lot of different interaction about how people answer the phone. You would be very surprised, or maybe you wouldn't, of some of the odd things that they feel like they can say to a customer on the phone. They may know a certain amount, but it's almost more important to understand what they don't know. They don't know what they don't know. I actually, when I was in college, I had a college professor that told me one of the most dangerous people in the world is a psychology student with one psychology class. It's not until you get further down in your studies that you actually begin to understand the nuances of what it means to be involved in the field of psychology. But a person with the first one class can actually be more dangerous with that information than somebody that's had years of knowledge and learning and understanding. It can be the same can hold true in propane. Somebody that's had one class with propane and then they hear all the field people coming in, you may not realize what, as a field person or a manager, when you come in and you say things out loud, what your CSR may be hearing. And they may not fully understand what you're saying. And then they take it and spin it and it morphs into something completely different. I know many of you have probably seen the CSR presentation that John Hansen has done. I've helped him with that a few times over the years. But we do a script and we talk about the CSR that tells the lady that calls and says, I smell gas. And she says, oh, don't worry about it. That's just, you know, your tank getting low. But the reality was it was actually a gas odor and she had a leak and there was an accident. That person, that CSR, heard the bobtail drivers coming through when she would say, oh my gosh, Mrs. Smith, she thinks she has a leak. But the bobtail driver would go, no, don't worry about it. She's just got, you know, her tank's down below 10%. So your field personnel in that situation actually retrained your CSR. She knew, but she didn't know enough, and management wasn't holding them all accountable. So if your leak or your odor complaint policy says you go and you investigate every time, then that wouldn't allow field personnel to tell the CSR, no, we're not going, don't worry about it. But when they are in a class that I'm hosting, I'm going to tell the CSR, you don't let anyone tell you you don't document something. You don't let anyone tell you you don't read the safety information, the warnings that you tell the person to get out of the building, to turn off the tank if it's safe, you know, no flames, no sparks, no electrical switches, and stay out until someone checks us out that's qualified to do so. You have to take care of your customer. So that CSR needs to understand that. They need to know what your expectations are, and you need to also hold them up. You need to make sure that those expectations are something that the management will uphold as well. Don't let anyone in the middle retrain your CSR to do something other than what you expect of them. So do they understand what you think their expectations are? Because if you let field personnel retrain them, then they're going to expect that you don't really want them to bother your service guy with an odor complaint. If you send that message, then that's the message that they're going to receive and that's how they're going to behave. So it's very important that we follow through. We need to use this potential within this group of employees. When you take the time to send them to a CSR course, when you take the time to send them through sales and safety training, PERC has a new customer service safety geared training that you can do through the LMS, so they don't even have to leave the office necessarily. But if you're going to invest in their training, then you need to understand what that training is also. I'm a fan. If you are an owner or a manager or an ops manager and you're watching this today, sit through the same course that you're going to require your employees to go through. Maybe you don't have to go through every single slide, but you should know what your employees are learning because you need to know how it's going to impact you when they come back to work. Use that potential, understand what they're going to learn, and then understand how it incorporates into your policies and procedures back at work. And then use that potential. Many, many companies actually outshine their competition by being very safety focused. When a customer service representative can demonstrate a level of safety knowledge, as well as the knowledge of the sales and services of the company, and they actually can take care of the customer without having to put them on hold for 5 or 10 minutes or have someone call them back, that's the kind of immediate responsiveness that consumers look for these days. So again, use that potential within the safety realm to improve overall performance of your employees. So the second question I have is who are they? These people are your first touch. They're the voice of your company. Your customers may know this person better than they know you. When they call, they expect to speak to the person that answers the phone. And if you have a new person that's hired, they're going to say, wait a minute, who are you? Where's the person, you know, where's Sue? Why isn't Sue on the phone? I don't know what's happening, you know. So they get to know your customers. You can ask them which ones are going to take 10 or 15 minutes when they call. They're going to know which ones are going to ask them all about their family, their last vacation, all kinds of stuff. Because Propane is a very small town in a lot of ways, even if it's a larger organization, we still kind of have a small town feel when it comes to our customers. So they're first touch, but they're also many times what I would say is last touch. They're the documentation trail. In almost every organization, the person or persons that are responsible for taking that initial call and writing up the service order, they're also going to be the person that that's turned back into. And they are also taking care of the filing and documentation and making sure that it's in order. So this is in their hands. Do they know why it's important? Do they know why they need to fill out that odor complaint log completely? And then that they need to follow up and make sure that the leak check got turned in and that everything gets filed? If they understand the importance that down the road, if something happens, that this documentation may show very clearly that we as a company, or you as your company, did everything possible, followed your policies to do everything to make sure that that customer stayed safe, is very important. We have to demonstrate that level of care. It's critical. So who do you ask for the paperwork? If you were going to say, hey, you know, those people that called in and smelled gas last week, you know, I think we got that all handled. Could you show me that paperwork? Who are you going to ask for that paperwork? So as you're thinking of who you would ask, are they in the office? Are they someone that you've ever sent to a training? Do you feel like they understand why it's important? Have you communicated that to them? At the end of the day, who is responsible? Who's responsible for training, for verifying and managing these people? It's you. It's not necessarily the CSR. They're following their role as your employee or your direct report. So make sure that you understand that that responsibility falls upon you to make sure that they not only were trained, but that you're verifying that they are understanding and that you're managing that function, that they understand the policies and procedures of the company. All right, so here's the third question. So what are they saying? Most priority calls, so the ones we call, you know, sensitive, safety sensitive, I smell gas, I think I have a leak, something's wrong, they're calls. So your office people are going to be taking that call. First call, CSR, let's call it. Their phone skills. Have you reviewed their phone skills with them? Have you provided them with any kind of scripts where they can practice? Do you record any of these calls for quality, for training purposes? And if you are recording those calls and you're not using those for those reasons, you're really, really missing out on an opportunity. So what happens if someone has a gas odor? What happens if they're asking, how do I light my pilot light? What if they're having an appliance issue? What are your expectations? I've talked to CSRs over my 20 years in training that it goes from any level of things. Some of them will say, oh, if they ask me about an odor complaint, I just tell them to call a plumber. Or if they say they smell gas, I tell them, we don't handle that. It's not our problem. It's in the house. I've had people that said, oh, light a pilot. Oh, yeah. I try to tell them how to light the pilot. And I asked that same person, you tell them how to light a pilot over the phone? And she goes, yes. And I said, do you know how to light a pilot at your house? No. So you kind of, I think, see the point I'm trying to illustrate. Sometimes managers, owners have expectations of what these people are supposed to be telling the employee or the customer, but they are not really taking into account that they don't have the level of training and knowledge necessary for some of these things. But some CSRs will take it to the other extreme. I spoke with one that said, oh, well, if they ask me anything like that, I just tell them it's illegal for me to tell you anything like that. Okay, that's too far the other way. And then there's the kind of clueless, the one that says, oh, well, you know, if I were you, I'd just Google it. Well, that's not a real good answer either. So that's, again, why we go back to practicing phone skills, practicing with scripts. What would you do if listening in on some recorded calls to confirm whether or not they're doing these according to your expectations and your policies and procedures? There is a very small window of time to triage a priority call, an emergency situation. They need to know what to do, how to respond, and how to keep the people on the other end of the phone as safe as possible. All right, so now we get to, so who is doing this training? A lot of us, as you are running the company day to day, this isn't your thing. You're not going to try to train all your employees yourself. So maybe you have someone inside that's doing that. You may hire someone. You may have external vendors that you've hired. You send your people out to, or you bring someone in to train them. Who is currently doing your CSR classes? A lot of times you have people doing bobtail, service, hazmat, but you may not have anybody that's currently doing a specific CSR class. You may be just sending them in with everyone else to CTEP basic. So basic principles and properties, don't get me wrong, good course, but I call it vocabulary. It's 101. This is where you start out. And for just a CSR that's never going to touch propane, I still maintain that it's overload. It's truly information overload that has a very large test at the end, and it's quite stressful. The new PERT training is much more condensed, much more designed to fit within the CSR world. And I personally would recommend it over just lumping them into a group going into basic. So the materials and the curriculum, that's kind of the discussion there. But so as you've gone through this, what obstacles have you experienced? This is just a carryover of the last slide. If you are bringing in someone for hire, an external person, somebody not within your company, but honestly, someone within your company, if they're going to train your CSRs, when was the last time that they had to answer the phone? And when was the last time they had to spend 5 days or 40 hours of a week taking calls, writing up service orders, answering just the day-to-day, well, how much is propane? How much is your tank lease? Do you have automatic delivery? When was the last time the person that's about to train your CSR spent 40 hours answering those phone calls? I know there are a lot of people out there that will throw out a basic class for a CSR. They've probably never been a CSR. They fill in when they have to. Yes, they can answer the questions, but they don't really know what it's like when you're running your fall fill-up or doing your pre-buy, what it's like to be sitting there in the office for that 40-hour work week, because they haven't had to do it. They've allowed the other people that work in the office to do that. I can tell you from personal experience, we know and we recognize the people that have had to live that experience. So make sure, if you're going to bring somebody in, that they have at least recently actually walked the walk, what you expect your CSRs to do each day. And then also make sure that the curriculum that you're using, again, that you have looked at it, gone through it to some level yourself, that it represents what you expect at your organization. And then if you have encountered obstacles, or they come out of the training and you find that there are obstacles, maybe they come out of training wanting to do a whole lot more on an odor complaint log than you're fully prepared to do, make those learning moments and find ways to learn from and adapt to, so that everybody gets something out of it at the end of the day. And then finally, who is being trained? And I only am supposed to go for 30 minutes, so I'm going to have to step this up a little bit. Who is being trained? Obviously, CSRs, any office staff, if they're ever going to answer the phone, then they need at least this most basic level of training. And in my belief, they need it before they're answering the phone without anybody supervising them. Quite honestly, they need the basic understanding of what is a safety sensitive call and how to handle it. If you use a call center or an after hours service, it's going to be very difficult for them to have any level of safety training regarding propane, but you need to have very specific rules, very specific call tree, certain parameters. They need to know what those rules are, and you need to verify that they're following them. We did some research and found that there were some that it took as long as 6 minutes to 10 minutes before anyone called anyone, and some were even longer. If you're expecting that as soon as they have someone say, "I smell gas," that they instantly call you, you may want to verify that from time to time, just to make sure. And then finally, field employees. If you believe that your field personnel will be never going to pick up the phone and answer a call, then your poor office staff must never get to go on vacation. Everybody needs to have at least the most basic, how do you handle a phone call? How do you write it up? What happens if they call in and they smell gas? If the service tech that's going to go out and do the investigation of the odor complaint answers the phone, he should still take the extra 30 seconds to write down what came in and where he's going. And then ultimately, when he comes back, complete the documentation process. Just because you're the field employee doesn't mean we don't have to do any documentation anymore. So yes, they do need to also understand at least your process of your policies and procedures for what your office personnel do, because you may be surprised that they may have to be the office personnel one day, or maybe for a few days due to a vacation or somebody being ill, any number of things. All right, so that was my last official slide. I know on a Zoom meeting, it's rather difficult to have a bunch of interaction, so can't really say that I'm going to be able to do any kind of discussion here, but thank you for the question that came in. And I would just say in conclusion that if you have challenges or obstacles with training your office personnel, talk through it with them, talk through it with who you're using as your trainer. I was a for-hire trainer for a number of years and also have worked with many state associations and other good folks that have been involved with state associations and PERC over the years, all fine individuals. So talk through it with the resources that you have. Check out the learning management system features, the learning center, see what tools that they have there. Anyway, I just would say that there's always a solution. There's always a way to inform and empower our employees to become that much better at their job. They can only be as good as we expect. We have a management person at our company that says, inspect what you expect. So, and I think that's definitely good advice. And if you have those expectations set forth, you send and invest in them in their training, then you need to follow up and make sure that the message that you sent is being received and was communicated, and that they're carrying that out to the level that you expect. So let's see, it says propane price rate discussions are always tricky. You have any negotiation type training recommendations for CSR? You're right. So those can be very tricky. I don't know if you've gone through the level one and level two sales training on the learning center, the PERC Learning Center. But it does have some discussion about that, about trying to steer it away from instantly giving them the price. We've all had to deal with those price checkers, and a lot of people, they will not engage. They just want to know the number so that they can call the next person. But yes, there are certainly things you can say like, okay, well, let me ask a few questions first before I give you the best price, or let me ask a few questions so that I can give you the best price. And that's legit, because if they're a new customer, you may have a special rate. You may be running some kind of discount for pre-buy or that kind of thing. And so you can ask a few questions, but don't give them the runaround. Nobody wants to have to answer 20 questions just to hear what your current rate is. So I would say keep it very clear and short, but that's usually the way I circumvent just an instant answer is, okay, let me ask you a few questions so that I can make sure I'm giving you the very best price. I would suggest checking out the level one and level two sales training in that learning center for more ideas. And then I would definitely say practice, do scripts. Absolutely sure. So Bill, I think I have come to the inevitable conclusion.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. And it's refreshing to actually hear from somebody who's been a customer service rep who actually grew up in the industry and has seen firsthand the different, you know, a lot of different offices, a lot of different companies, both when you're at the association and now. So it's really helpful. Thanks a lot.
Absolutely. Perfect. So pleased to be here. Thanks again, Bill.
Yeah, thanks a lot. So tomorrow morning, we have a bunch of presenters lined up following on Paula Laney from EDP and her CSR training. Thank you, Paula. Moving on tomorrow, we'll have Crystal DiStefano. And this is an interesting one. She and her partner had been a PR director for a really large fuel delivery company that I had been a part of until it got purchased and bought out by another propane company. So as a PR company, they've been helping our industry for decades. And speak and teach at some of the colleges also on public relations. A fabulous company from a perspective of helping propane companies and fuel delivery companies, multi-fuel companies, when times are tough, helping them navigate through troubled waters and helping them prepare for those and set up the company for their image that you rightly want and most likely deserve. That's going to be a great one. That's kicked off at 10 a.m. Eastern time tomorrow, followed by Amy Allen, who is going to be speaking on leading with emotional intelligence. She helps a lot of fuel companies work through image as well, grassroots perspective. So next up after that is going to be Mark Stillman with the Energy Engine, talking about technology and leveraging it. Really interesting story there. John Vrabel, if you see on the screen right now, started the company and is one of the leaders in leveraging technology to grow a business. And, you know, think 20 years ago, Amazon was leveraging technology to grow a business. And well, this John Vrabel has kind of did some of the same things at the same time and has been involved with some very interesting techniques to grow fuel delivery companies, kind of the grandfather for that in our industry. Followed then by Paul Baumgartner, who is with the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration. So the Federal Carrier Safety Administration, regulatory updates. Hearing to hear it from the horse's mouth, you'll want to, you know, this is a really rare gem that we can have him in this, followed by the NFPA organization. So the organization that helps update our code book is going to be presenting, and you'll be hearing it right again from the horse's mouth there too. Next after that is going to be the Transportation Compliance Company, and they have been helping our industry for about 27 years with the transportation compliance requirements in our industry, truly experienced in that area. And one thing I thought was really interesting about them, every client that they started with 27 years ago is still using their services. I think that's fabulous. That's customer service and a great product, I would imagine. So we'll hear something about how we can protect ourselves and some tips there that they've been helping their clients with for 27 years. And lastly, AccuGPS. If you ever heard of BlackBerry, remember, you might even remember the word CrackBerry. Remember that, Paula? You know, so, you know, it used to be the thing, right?
It did.
If you ever wondered what happened to the engineers that made the BlackBerry devices, well, come and check out AccuGPS and their presentation and find out what are they doing that technology, because it was always considered the safest, most secure, most encrypted technology for cell phone usage and smartphone usage. What are those engineers doing now? Well, they're involved in a new version and a new level of GPS tracking and a whole lot more, like the next generation, the next where that whole field has transitioned to and how we can take advantage of it. Obviously, lower prices and much more features and functions. So some really cool presenters tomorrow. We're going to try to record all of them if you can't quite be there. but please join us. And again, want to thank, you know, direct you to and ask you, please visit the sponsors. Here's some of them right here. Green LP, James River, One Tank, which we heard just previous to this presentation. Fabulous new way to really leverage the technology that we call tank monitors and really take it to the next level. Energy Engine Tomorrow, Digital Software Services. And I want to highlight one of their products. This is the custom fuel app, an app that you can put your logo on, your company name, and instantly have an Apple and Android app on the App Store with your name, your logo, your brand. And, you know, it does a couple critical things. Paula, don't we hate churn? Don't we hate the, you know, we say we got to lock the back door, prevent customers from leaving, right? Mm-hmm. Well, this is how you lock the back door. The custom fuel app. People don't want to leave once they can use your app to order their fuel. Paula, remember when we propane before the yellow, you know, before the websites, it was Yellow Pages, right?
Oh, and can you imagine? Yeah, I remember my dad was such a big deal deciding how large a Yellow Page ad to purchase.
And it was
I don't
expensive.
Even know where to find a phone. They were. I don't know where to find a phone book anymore. None of us use phone books ever.
Do you remember how many Yellow Pages your dad had to be in? There's the North County, the South County, Yellow Book, Yellow Pages, there's Shepherd's
yes.
Guide. I mean, it was
all of them
were like hundreds of dollars per month, right?
Yeah. So, oh, yeah.
And most of us, Paul, were you involved in the industry when your dad was thinking, do I get a website? Should I do that? Get a website? Remember that?
I wish he would consider an app because I do. And I'm, obviously, my parents still have a company and I'm not involved.
Well, but, I didn't know that.
Yeah, that he does. But, it's, you know, small. It's his retirement thing. He's truly never going to stop. But yeah, an app, I mean, that's just where it's at. I pay my bills using an app.
And you know, this COVID thing has really changed stuff. So people are doing that more and more. So really, I think that everything's going to just really changing faster because of the whole COVID. Everybody's moving to technology a little more. Everybody's ordering more from Amazon. My
yes.
neighbors, you know, their front porch is always covered with this stuff from Walmart or Amazon, right?
Right.
And, anyway, so this app is, it costs almost nothing, costs less than the cost of one propane tank, and you can automate your customers and automate the, you know, less phone calls. Think of this, Paula, imagine this, Uber, which is just a commodity delivery company, they deliver humans, 18 million same day orders a day. Can you imagine?
No kidding.
In the fuel industry, so they do that without a single phone call, without a single customer service rep, without a single office. That's insane, right? So 18 million same day orders, that's Uber. And this is Uberizing our fuel delivery company. So check out Custom Fuel App. And it's one of our sponsors. Just go to the sponsors. And TankSpotter, voted by PERC NPGA World Propane Gas Association as the best safety technologies, best safety app, best mobile app in North America. So if you're looking for a safety application, check it out. If you're looking for an app that does that costs less than any others out there and does more than any others out there and was voted best by, it's being used by thousands of people, thousands of techs and drivers right now are using this thing. So check that out. It's really great. I think you might want to take a peek at it. So thank you so much, everyone, for being here. Paula, thanks for staying with us all to the very end. And really appreciate it. And a shout out to EDP for letting you be here and teach and coach and train and just really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks again. See ya.